It's one of the biggest events on the yearly video gaming calendar. Now in its 10th year, the annual Penny Arcade Expos, or PAX, these conventions provide the general public a 3 or 4 day experience of gaming bliss, whether you're a console gamer, PC, tabletop, casual, or more experienced. There's something for everyone here, and on this episode, we'll recap this year's PAX East, held annually in Boston, Massachusetts. What was in store for us this year? Well, you'll have to listen to find out. It's our annual PAX recap, next on Downloadable Content. Welcome to Downloadable Content. I'm Brian, and with me on this episode, we have Ben.
Hey, everybody.
We have Doug, once again, a non-Nintendo episode.
I know, it's getting scary. You keep having me back.
Appearing for his second time, we have Jon.
Hello.
And we have Wyatt.
Hello, hello.
Actually, Brian, I heard a rumor, and Doug, maybe you can substantiate this. I heard you were Nintendo's representative at PAX. Is that something you can confirm?
Look, they're just struggling to get some stuff out, but they're not that desperate just yet.
Doug is
E3 goes.
Doug is the new Reggie.
I would be so behind that if I were as a shareholder. And I like Reggie.
So, before I get into the episode at hand, I've got a few plugs to throw out there. Doug hails from AnimeCons TV.
Yep. Our lovely weekly video podcast there, talking convention stuff, so I guess I'm somewhat qualified to talk about stuff here for some reason.
All right, Reg. And Jon and Wyatt hailing from their gaming blog, Sprites And Dice.
Absolutely. Going on 1 year, actually, pretty much from today, or, like, this week.
Well, congratulations!
I've got to check the date on that. I wonder when the first post is.
It was sometime this week, maybe.
On this time.
Why are
a
you
month after last year's PAX?
Not check the facts on this one.
No, it's fine, it's totally this week. Don't look! There's no reason for you to look!
And finally, some plugs of my own. Downloadable Content can be found on iTunes, YouTube, and Stitcher. You can get a hold of us at facebook.com/dlcontent, on Twitter at dlcontent, and on Tumblr, dlcpodcast.tumblr.com. And if you still use email, you can get in touch with us, dlcontent1@gmail.com. So, now that I've got the obligatory crap out of the way, let us dive in.
It was terrible. Every moment of it.
Worst PAX ever.
It was the worst convention I've ever been to.
That's it. Episode over.
I've never been to a convention before where so many people complained that they actually gave us all our money back, which was awesome, but kind of sucked because we were in Boston at the time. So,
yeah, well, that'll happen. So, for me, this was my third PAX. Doug, I know this was your first.
Yep.
Wyatt, your third.
Third and a half, yeah.
Third and a half. Ben, I think was your second? Second or third?
Second, yeah. I bought tickets for last year, but I couldn't go.
And Jon, I think this is your second or third as well. So.
Third.
Third. Okay. Yeah. So, Doug here is the... Doug finally made it to PAX East after years of, you know...
I've been living in the Boston area going on 7.5 years.
It's in your backyard, for fuck's sake! But no, you'll go all over the country for various anime conventions, but you don't go to the one that's right in your backyard.
Something always came up, and I almost had it. I almost had a conflict this year. I almost had two conflicts. two of my former residents from when I was an RA were going to get married, and then they had to postpone. And so I'm like, oh, wait, I actually have this weekend free. I used to work at a hotel in the area. but, yeah, it's... I'm glad I finally got to it. I mean, my big realization was gaming is secondary for me to a lot of other nerdy pursuits, but I still manage to have a really good time. It is such a different creature from other cons that I go to. And it's...
Well, I mean, obviously, I mean, I know that at Anime Boston, you actually work there, so...
Yep. I am the currently their facilities manager, which makes interesting adventures, especially when PAX is the same weekend. Speaking of things coming up, and all of a sudden we have to start talking with the convention center authority because they run both the convention center that PAX is in and where Anime Boston, and we have to start saying, okay, we need down to the exact number how many chairs you have. So we don't use, make sure you don't run out and things like that.
So we're going to press forward into day one. I mean, this is the first time, at least for me, that I was actually there for the entire convention as opposed to just getting there Friday.
Oh, yeah, I actually showed up on Thursday night for once.
Yeah, that's the first time that's happened, which was nice, because last year, when I got to PAX, I showed up just in time for the Friday night concerts.
Oh, that's rough.
You didn't miss some good stuff.
Well, we had to... I mean, I couldn't get out of class, and we had to wait even longer because... welcome back, Wyatt. We had to wait a while because Ryan was driving his own car, and he got lost in the Braintree clusterfuck.
Oh, jeez.
So
That was not fun driving there.
No, so... But yes, this was the first time we were actually there for the entire 3 days, and one of the things that I noticed immediately off the bat after we got in was... how much more they gave indie developers on the expo floor. I mean, if you don't know out there, wide world of internet, a lot of the big names were not present at PAX this year, so you had no Capcom, no EA, no Nintendo, except for Doug, and...
I'm not a good kid.
And no Sony. I know that Nintendo basically said, we're not going to be there because we have nothing to show... And so I pretty much assume that it was kind of across the board for most of the other guys, but that allowed a noticeable expansion of the indie floor,
which was amazing.
Yeah, and that's time and again from both my experience and people that were kind of giving me tips when they found out I was able to go were saying kind of that's the thing to check out. Because you're not sitting in, you know, a line for a couple hours waiting for a demo. These are people that are pretty much available right away, and you can actually really engage them and find out what they're up to.
And did.
Yes.
I know this is jumping a little bit, but it was really funny that, I mean, the indie booth was huge, and it was absolutely amazing that, I think the way I worded it was that for, like, every major group that removed themselves from PAX East this year, it was able to allow like four to eight entirely new organizations or just small mini groups appear to show off their games. You get to talk to the developers, you get to talk to the people that worked right on it. And that was awesome. And it was really funny that it caught on so quick. So on Friday, I went to the indie booth and I was able to walk around. There was a room. I could talk from developer to developer. It was a pretty quick process. I tried doing the same thing on the same time Saturday, and people had wisened up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, Saturday is usually the busiest day of the three anyway. But, you know, just... I mean, that's one of the biggest reasons why I go to PAX, because PAX, you know, whether you agree or disagree, or you're boycotting PAX for legitimate reasons, that's one of the biggest ways that that indie developers get exposure. I mean, PAX is a you have a huge potential audience, and indie developers are so eager to talk to anybody about their product. You know, get their product out there, word of mouth, and you know, a lot of them had playable demos.
And like the thing that struck me was, with like every indie developer there, like if they had something, I never felt like somebody was being like pushy. Like if I was like on my way to meet someone or just said, you know, no thank you, they were fine to let me on my way. And I liked that. Like I didn't feel like anyone was shoving me into their booth. I always felt like it's like, hey, come on. It's like, oh no, you'll catch us later. Cool. And that was awesome because that's so different from what you're used to, where it's like, come see our game, you're gonna do it now, kind of ordering you around. And it was very refreshing, and I think it kind of comes from that community of these are kind of fellow gamers first, salesmen second. And that's something that really stood out to me.
One of the developers that I spent a good chunk of time with. The developer is Grimm Brothers Inc. And
Yes.
And they are developing a game called Dragon Fin Soup. And I was very intrigued by the premise. It's an RPG with roguelike elements. And it incorporates a lot of ideas and tropes from fairy tales, I mean, hence the name of the company, Grimm Brothers. But you get to play as Little Red Riding Hood. However, Little Red Riding Hood comes with some guns, and she's a raging alcoholic. So, while I didn't actually get to play the demo because there were already several people playing, I got to speak to the developer, you know, for a good long time about it. They actually had timed their Kickstarter for this game so that it ended with day one at PAX, and they were successful. So this game is going to go ahead, and I'm really intrigued by the premise, and I am definitely looking forward to that game when it comes out. It won't be for a while yet. So that was probably the game that stuck out to me the most on day one. What about the rest of you?
Sure.
That's funny. It's just because, I mean, Dragon Fin Soup wasn't even in the official indie booth area. This, again, shows how large it is in terms of that segment of the floor.
Yeah.
I wish we could show a picture of it.
Went over. Like, I'm pretty sure most of the booths surrounding the indie booths were also indies. It just happened to be that, like, that entire section, you could get lost and you like your friend would ask you, "Where are you?" And you're like, "Indie booth, somewhere."
Yeah, that's yeah. What I had a lot of people in texting like, "Where are you?" But and we get a lot of, "Well, I'm in the indie booth," and then people would be like, "Well, that's nice. Let me find you for an hour."
Yeah, I was always texting by landmark. Oh, I'm by the giant headphones. Which giant headphones? There's three. Yeah, I mean, trying to navigate that was a little tough, but I mean, I'd rather have that huge volume where there's, you know, almost too much that it's hard to take in than feel like it's, you know, an afterthought.
I agree. I mean, this is the first time I've been able to make it to PAX East for all 3 days, in terms of just from open to close, pretty much. The first real time I've been able to do that. And I thought, okay, I'm finally going to have the time. And I still didn't. I still just did not have the time in the Expo Floor to see absolutely everything. Every time I'd go home and start feeling pretty good about myself in terms of like, oh well, I got to see pretty much everything. I got what I, you know, wanted. And, you know, someone would just tell me, or one of the other people I was living with for the weekend was saying, "Oh well, did you check out this booth?" "No." "Did you see this cool thing they were handing out?" "Just no." "Damn it!" It was just this constant barrage of great things. It doesn't feel like it was just all sounds and noise because you had this push of the indie booth. I'm going to keep saying that. But that push allowed for so many ways you could just get hands-on with the developers. And I think Jon can back me up with this, especially for me and Jon, we spent the next week after the expo talking about how different it was going back there as kind of game pseudo-journalists, and we had written some articles. Jon had written some articles for some of the indie booths, and he was able to go back up to them, and we had these little fancy new business cards, and we were handing them out saying, hey, if you want to just mention us, and we'll write an article about your game, and we'll kind of, you know, meet up later. And suddenly there was developers that were, you know, saying, oh, wait, Jon, we know you from Twitter. We started talking to you on Twitter, and...
That was weird for me.
And, oh, I God, mean, recognition!
Yeah. No, like, I did not expect a single one of them to remember me, and I think the Someone first did. Booth I gunned for was the Men with men Who Wear Many Hats, and they had that arcade machine, Max Gentleman, where the game where you were this guy in a suit who had a top hat, and every time you grabbed a beer, you get another top hat, you had to jump the hats over beers flying across the screen. And I remember last year, they had that game set up on like an iPad plugged into an iCade, like over in the corner, and they were displaying some other game as like their main attraction. And this year they came back because that game was so popular, and they had a full arcade machine just for Max Gentleman. And I remember last year I wrote an article about Max Gentleman, and it happened to be the only one you would find if you ever Googled the game. And that got us a significant amount of traffic, more than I thought. And,
it was one of our first big breaks in terms of like traffic to our site.
And I remember checking the page sources, and we found it was linked back to a Reddit thread. What was the question? Oh yeah, what was the most homoerotic game you've ever played? And we got like 100 hits from that link.
No, we got I think two. I think it was more a few hundred by the end of it. But we were just like, whoa, this Twitter and Reddit thing works. At least for me, I got my Twitter for the like 2 days after PAX because I realized like after Jon came back and was like, yeah. So I was talking to the developers, and then when I saw them in real life, they recognized me. And just to have that personal connection was so awesome. I mean, I didn't so much have that going in like Jon did, but what I did have was as I went in for the first time and I started handing out my card to these developers, I wasn't just like, oh yeah, that's nice, maybe we'll talk to you. Like, some of them just started really like putting aside time, and they wanted to have us listen to them. They wanted to, you know, because, and we would even say, hey, look, we're not a big group, we've only got a few, you know, we're up to like 22,000 views right now, but back then it was like 20,000. So we were saying, okay, we've only got like 20,000 views, we don't have a lot, but they're like, no, we want to share it, and if you can spread it all, that'd be great. But it's great to just have someone that's this interested in the gaming community, and it was just so great to have that. I don't think I could pick out one single game that really blew me away. I think the two that I would have to agree on would be the Orcs Must Die Unchained. And the reason for that was because I remember when Orcs Must Die, the original game, was at PAX in 2011, and it had a small booth with like two regular-sized computers. And now if anyone else, I know Ben did, Ben went back with me on Saturday to play the game. They had 16 computer screens, they had this huge setup, they were able to give out beta codes like crazy, and they had these amazing like 5-on-5 games. Sorry, they had 20 then. 20 computers, and it was just great seeing that they were able to do these amazing, how they've expanded over the course of just 3 years, and they went from being like really feeling like a small indie booth to being this kind of not quite, you know, major company, of course, but have that where they've grown their fan base, and they're able to show up and give so much more. On the other end of it, it would definitely be Night Squad, which is a game by a company called Chainsaw Awesome Games, which first off, we're just let that sink in. Second off, Night Squad is pretty much a mixture of Bomberman meets Pac-Man, but give everybody swords. Like, it's just a fantastic game that I was not on my radar at all, and I walked by and someone was like, oh, here's a controller. And I went, sure, it looks like it has a great logo with a knight on it. It looks a little bit goofy. What happens? And then I see them hand out seven other controllers, and all of a sudden we're all at a 50-inch screen TV screaming at each other, trying to get the Holy Grail in the middle of the board. And failing, as we were just killing each other left and right. It was fantastic.
Oh, very good. What about you, Ben?
I didn't really spend that much time in the indie booth, which is part of why I've been so quiet during most of this conversation. I'm certainly glad that there is a large indie presence there, and I definitely appreciate that it exists and all of the fun games that indie developers do make. Wyatt mentioned Orcs Must Die. That is certainly one of the titles I was thinking of. And of course, Bastion got its first public showing at PAX a couple of years ago. We all know what happened with that. And
oh, yeah.
Predictably, the line for Transistor was absurd.
couldn't play it. I couldn't get on it.
Yeah, no, I didn't bother. I was like, this is awesome, and I can't wait to buy it in a month, but I don't want to just wait on this line. The line that I literally never saw not capped was for Oculus Rift. It was just, there was absolutely no point when I saw that line and it was not fully capped. So that's kind of encouraging. At least it's a curiosity. But on the other hand, that was exactly what happened in 2006 at E3 when Nintendo was showing off the Wii for the first time. And we saw what happened there. So not saying that the Oculus Rift is going to go down the same path as the Wii in terms of what kind of game developments actually come out of it. But anyway, yeah, so I didn't really spend a ton of time on the indie stuff, so I really can't comment much on what was going on there.
Anybody go to any panels on the first day?
On the first... Oh, yes. Cards Against Humanity. And that was a show. That line formed within 2 seconds, because everyone had camped out the line for the panel right before it, and as that line cleared out into the theater... The enforcers pretty much stood in the middle of the floor, counted to three, and then I watched about, I don't know, 100 nerds crash into each other to fit into a tiny square taped off. That was an interesting panel, because if you've ever been to a Cards Against Humanity panel before, basically what they do for the thing is they have all the fans suggest cards, and then they say which ones suck, which ones don't, and they say, maybe we'll get these into the game. This time what happened was, after the panel... after at least the suggestion part had ended, they stalled for a good half hour and then FaceTimed one of their employees who happened to be at a printing shop in Boston. And she had turned
to be.
Yeah, happened to be.
By
she had
sheer
turned
coincidence.
Her phone, and we get to watch as the cards we had just suggested were getting printed out. And they told us to look under our seats, and we all had these special pins that we were to bring to the booth the next day. And they all gave us all these exclusive packs that had 10 cards that we made that night.
That's nuts. That's awesome.
Yeah, Cards Against Humanity was... They pretty much pulled all the sneakiest stuff during that weekend. They also were responsible for Pawn Meal, if you guys saw the advertisements
yes.
for that.
That was hilarious.
That was my biggest thing for, like, why I was, like, so bummed that it was taking me forever to get a swag bag.
Yeah.
Was I found out about that.
Not only that, but everyone was going back for them. They were trying to get all of the swag, of the, like, I was at a table for a good hour while all these people were going around, like, handing out their doubles. We had this huge stack of, like, a common pile.
That's for, you know, like, out in the middle of the floor, what they had for double we're looking for.
Yeah.
And guys, you want to explain what Pawn Meal was for the people who aren't aware of it? I mean, I am, but I'm just, you know, for I realize that there are not everybody that's listening to our podcast was actually at PAX, so.
True. So, in the swag bags, they gave us oatmeal packets. And I actually let mine sit there for a good portion of the day until my friend had told me, did you open up the oatmeal? Which, you know, would be an odd question to open up oatmeal in the middle of the convention floor.
But, yeah. It's not a question for anybody but gamers. I mean, did you open up the oatmeal could easily be the next meme.
Anyway, inside the packets were 10 randomly picked Cards Against Humanity cards exclusive to PAX. And I think there were a total of 27. So not only were we, like, you know, sitting around the floor trading cards, but we were covered in oatmeal because we had to rip open individual oatmeal packets to get to all of these.
I have a funny Pwn Meal story. This is like right. This felt like right out of an RPG. I was Ben and I were going somewhere.
We were online for the first round of the Omegathon.
Right, we were on our way there. You stopped to get a pretzel. So yep. I'm waiting. I'm waiting on the other side of the hall, and some random guy.
Yeah, I thought he was a buddy of yours. I was so confused.
Some random guy, it's like an NPC, just walks up to me and goes, did you open your oatmeal yet? And I
What are you buying?
Yeah, and I give
what
him this...
What are you selling?
I give him this weird look. No. And he said, you should open your oatmeal. And he walks off. That's all he says. Did you? That's all he does.
Right, he really was an NPC. Like, he is the ultimate NPC in this story.
So I reach into my messenger bag where I put my swag bag, and I look at this pwn meal, and I'm like, it's oatmeal. Oh, all right. I open it up, and I'm like, ah!
I was so pissed.
And then, later on, Ryan and I had met up. We were online for food. We got our food, dinner. Yeah, because this was just before the Friday night concerts. And I look at Ryan, and I do the same thing. Did you open your oatmeal? And he gives me the same strange look, like,
what are you talking about?
No. And I go, open your oatmeal. And he tries to ask me, like, why? I'm like, and I don't, just open it. And he opens, and he's like, oh, they're cards! And I said, yeah, now we're trading, you know, cards and whatnot. So that was my, that's like the pwn meal story of the,
Yeah. So I have to ask, and I will start with, I'll add a special word here. Did anyone else, because I know I did, actually make the instant oatmeal that came with it?
No. They suggested not to.
Oh, oops.
Was it good at least?
It was very disappointing instant oatmeal, but it was definitely instant oatmeal.
Tasted nothing like the flavors they had on
one of the pans. Oh, yeah, no. Like, yeah, I had, like, strawberry and carnage. I tasted no strawberries and no carnage.
Oh.
But, yeah.
You know...
Yeah, this is a neat collector's item, though, to watch. And, like, if you go on, like, eBay right now, like... Full sets, like the cheapest I'm seeing a full set for is at like $45 right now.
For oatmeal.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I have a bunch of the packets still and a couple spare cards.
Well, I'm trying to pawn off my Magic starter deck that I got at PAX because I don't play Magic. So we'll see if anybody buys that on eBay. So, did anyone else go to any other panels? Because I wanted to. And the thing about PAX is that I see the schedule, and there's all these panels I want to go to, but I make it to almost none of them. Because I'm otherwise occupied with... I'm either gaming, or I'm on the tabletop floor, or anything like that. Because if nobody went to any other panels, I mean, we'll just go right into the Friday night concerts.
I did actually end up going to one panel. Okay. Just a quick note... It was one on RPGs and their history, and it was where it was going to be going next. And this was about tabletop RPGs, so Dungeons and Dragons and otherwise. It was a very interesting event because it actually wasn't quite what was said on the panel, because they ended up running out of time before they got to the future. It ended up being almost like a history lesson from some of the people that have been in the industry since the 80s. So it was very interesting to go from like the show floor to go to something like that, where it was very laid back. It wasn't like Cards Against Humanity, it sounds like, where it was just like this mad dash and a lot of like high energy. This was much more of just like a sit back, enjoy, appreciate. And that's what I was able to do. It was really great hearing about how the industry started, hearing all those differences. And again, I think I'm going to go back to that theme that I seem to keep building with this, which is community is so huge at Penny Arcade Expo. Whenever I've been there, one with the developers being right there, or people that love the game, and I can go into 100 other examples. I won't right now, but I can. And then when you have the developers going into panels and talking, where a lot of these guys that were answering the questions, some people who had been some of the first people that got Kickstarter successful in RPGs, and that was one of the huge things they talked about, how Kickstarter's changed gaming. And that I found really fun, because I remember going to a panel about that, I want to say, in 2011. And I remember Steve Jack answering someone who said, hey, what do you think about Kickstarter, when they did Q&A? And the guy was pretty much laughed off and said, well, no, that's usually done just for vanity games. And, you know, things you just want you and a few friends to play. You know, you might get, like, one run, but that's it. And now, you know, it's 2014, and we all know how that's changed the game. Their start on Kickstarter, and it's created this huge community uproar, not uproar, kind of upswell of being able to have more of their hands in the industry, and I love that. I absolutely love that they do that. So that was really fun to listen to, just to see how things have changed so dramatically in 30 years, and then see the developers and see these people that have helped generate these games and these books sit out there, and after the presentation was over, we had to get shooed out of the room because they had someone else going in there. But they were out there for a good half hour just answering questions from people, and, you know, what do they think is the next big thing going to be, and it's always great to have that.
Cool. That sounded like a lot of fun, actually.
It was really laid back. So I kept sitting there like, I have to go back to the expo floor. Why am I not at the expo floor? Why are there not all the shiny flashing lights everywhere?
But I feel great. I feel sad.
A little bit. Not gonna lie. But it was kind of nice to just kind of take a load off and enjoy it in a different fashion. There's so much to see, and there's so many different ways to go and attack the con, so to speak.
Yeah, I remember I went to the Indie Mega Booth panel on Sunday, kind of by chance, because I showed up late on Sunday because I had food poisoning, and I just sat in the back, and the place was mostly empty, and it was probably my favorite panel of the whole convention. I was just three of the people from the Mega Booth just talking about their experience of starting it and how 2 years ago, like, the Indie Booth was barely a thing. And by the end of the Q&A, they were just really encouraging everyone in that room to go and make stuff and just do what they wanted to do.
Absolutely.
I didn't really get into any of the panels, just like anytime there was one I was considering, it already had a line out the door. How were the size of the panel rooms? Were there any that like were never filled? Because it seemed like everything filled up pretty quick.
Well, the indie panel I went to was barely even half full, and there were people just filtering in and out the whole time.
Yeah, the more laid-back ones, they definitely weren't, like, stuffed to the brim, where it wasn't, like, about a game that was about to be announced or one of the bigger groups.
Because, like, I mean, once again, I mean, I'm very different perspective. There was, you know, only a couple of panels that kind of caught my interest, and by the time it was, like, you know, I used the guidebook app to remind me, and they're like, oh, you know, 30-minute reminder, and then by the time I got to the booth, the line was already, you know, well out the door. So it was, you know, it's just interesting to see kind of the contrast of that. And, you know, I'm you know, always kind of someone who wants to see more seated programming to try and get, you know, just like you said, that community of more people interacting with each other and, you know, kind of connecting.
And we welcome Shanna to the fray.
A new challenger approaches.
Welcome, Shanna.
Sorry.
Shanna, if you didn't say it, I was going to be very disappointed if somebody didn't make that joke.
You're welcome.
So, Shanna, we'll get to you in a bit. We were talking about, you know, what panels we saw on day one. So, if you have anything to add to mention, feel free to say so now. If not, we're going to go into the Friday night concerts.
Okay, go on ahead.
Okay. Well then, so Friday night concerts, we had some new performing groups this year. I mean, usually some of the PAX standards, as it were not present. There was no Proto Men, no Jonathan Colton. But, so the Friday night concert started off with Bit Brigade, which was a group that I had never heard of. Most of the groups for Friday and Saturday, I had never heard of. But, started off with Bit Brigade, and their shtick is like this. They're a band, you know, rock band. You know, they play rock versions of video game music. However, there's one unique twist. They play the music of the game of somebody is on stage with them, the designated player, and he speed runs through a game. All the while, the band behind him is playing the music to that game or that franchise. So, for this show, the player was playing the original Legend of Zelda for the NES, and meanwhile, the guys behind him are working up one hell of a sweat playing the music to this game. And, you know, this guy puts me to shame because 23 years, I still haven't beaten the original Legend of Zelda. This guy speed ran it in 45 minutes. And I looked at him with admiration. On the one hand, one half of me is going, well done. The other half is going, fuck you.
The thing that I was blown away by was the fact that he was doing it in the center of the stage with no headphones or like noise-canceling devices that I could see on, and he's looking at a 10-inch screen TV for, you know, the good 8-bit Zelda, and it's getting blown up on those 20-foot screens on either side. So that was just, I'm like watching, like, okay, I would, my ADHD would be driving me insane right there.
Intense concentration.
Rote memorization.
And the second part that I absolutely loved was how, like, as it started, people were like, yeah, okay, this is kind of cool, and, you know, kind of, like, slowly kind of nodding their heads and getting a little bit more into it. But every time you got a piece of the Triforce, they'd play that jam, and you'd just see several people. I think Jack was one of the first people in our group that would just, you know, hold up and do the Triforce symbol. And as he got more and more pieces of the Triforce, every single time there'd be a little bit more of the audience putting up the Triforce. And so when he got to the end, Ganon, like, everyone just stood up where they were and just did the set. Like, it was really fun to just see that generation of energy.
Not only did he speedrun through Zelda in 45 minutes, he collected every upgrade and every heart container except one. And so he sliced Ganon like it was a hot knife through butter. I'm like, fuck you! But my god, well done! It's, you know... And, you know, that was a great show. And I talked to the player. I don't know his name, so I'm just referring to him as the player. I caught up with him the next day and asked him if that music was available, because down in the band section they had... Because they've done... They're based in Georgia. And they've done concerts where they've speed run Mega Man, Contra, Castlevania, Ninja Gaiden... Noah McCarthy. Okay, thank you, Ben.
I had his card because I got one when I bought that print for Wyatt.
Okay.
Yes.
So, and Ninja Gaiden, I have to have... I'm like, okay, I can't get past level 6-2 on that fucking game. How the hell do you speedrun it? But anyway,
I bought the DVD that they had, that they were selling, their speedrun of Contra, which I'm very much looking forward to, because apparently it's... actually not that long, which is even more horrifying and impressive.
I asked him. 17 minutes.
Yeah, that's absurd. How about this? Mega Man 2, apparently the videos that they have on YouTube is about 45 minutes. I am so looking forward to that.
So, that was an amazing... set. And so they haven't put out their Zelda music yet. But you can find a lot of their stuff over on Bandcamp. So if you want to buy any of their stuff, go right ahead. The group that followed, Metroid Metal.
Oh, man, they're one of my favorites.
Now, unfortunately, I had to leave the theater at this point because my ears were hurting from the throbbing bass.
Yeah, they were very good. The problem I had from personally, and this is not a knock on Metroid Metal at all, but the problems for me were twofold. Number one, I have way more of a connection to music from the Legend of Zelda series than I did to Metroid, which is my, not even failing, but, you know, it's because of me, not, you know, it's not their fault that I've played more Zelda games than I've played Metroid games, but I did feel that they were, and I mean, that's, metal is obviously going to be much louder music. It was just, with that size room, with that volume, it was a little much for me. And when I could clearly, perfectly hear them outside the room without it hurting my ears, I decided that that was the better place to hang out.
Were they in the main room, or like the big main theater? Or?
Yeah, the main theater, upstairs.
Yeah, the sound in there is a little bit wacky. I can see where that could kind of, the acoustics might not be just
and
right.
Listen,
I missed
again,
that show,
they,
yeah.
They were great, they were just way louder than what I wanted to hear at that point.
Meanwhile, both Metroid and Metal were like, two huge things growing up for me, so they kind of stuck with me. Actually, I'm pretty sure they introduced me into metal, now that I think of it.
The third and final group, I cannot even pronounce their name.
Anamanaguchi.
Thank you! My tongue just runs over itself when I try to pronounce it. I did not stick around for that. So if anybody did, let's hear
I
it.
I did. Actually, that was the only one I made it to on Friday because I the Cards Against Humanity panel ran until about 11, I think. So I caught the tail end of Onomatoguchi. And those guys are just pure audiovisual bliss in like, music form.
That was the one concert I wanted to make.
Like, oh, yeah.
I think I just ran out of steam because I had to work that morning. But I've heard a bunch of their stuff, and it's just so much fun.
What kind of music do they do?
Brian,
chiptune. They did the soundtrack to the Scott Pilgrim versus the World game.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you want one example of what kind of music they would make, they made the they did the album for the video game of Scott Pilgrim versus the World.
Okay.
And it's just fun stuff. Like it feels, you know, just think of like your favorite NES music in that style, and it's, you know, all their original stuff. It's not they're covering somebody else's. This is their own original music. So I think if anything, they were kind of one of the big names for Friday night.
Yeah, I saw them, I think, just about a year ago, right after they released their most recent album, and they brought the same energy to like this dinky basement show back in Connecticut. And they just like, you can't not be happy watching them play.
Well, if they come back to PAX next year, I will definitely give them a shot. Because while that concert was going on, I headed down to probably, I think, one of the last panels of the evening, which was their game show night. So they were doing Jeopardy. And, you know, it's the end of the night. It's about 10 o'clock, 10:30 at night. And so the panel was probably about, the room was probably about two-thirds filled. And so, you know, three people testing their nerd cred with Jeopardy. Although the host had to tell the audience a few times to stop giving away the damn answers.
Well, that just, like, kills the fun of it. Why would you give away the answers?
Although, you know, I figured that I knew most of the answers, or most of the questions, I should say, that they were showing up there, but like the final Jeopardy ones were interesting. Like they did two games, and the first one was I did not get. It was, you know, this movie was, and I told this to Ben and Doug. I was like, this movie was the first full length feature that Marvel ever did, and it was Howard the Duck.
Oh, yes. Oh.
You mean, oh, no.
We don't talk about that. I mean,
we don't speak of that.
Hey, to give you an idea of the feel of that, to bring it back to video games, in Lego Marvel, the trophy you get if you unlock Howard the Duck is titled, Really?
The second game of Jeopardy, I did know, because the category was banned games, and the answer was, this game was denied classification in the UK because of, quote, callousness of tone, and it was Manhunt 2.
Oh, yeah. I remember that whole deal.
So, and then after that, and by this time, almost everybody left, because then they did a version of the game show Pyramid, which, you know, if you're old enough to remember, in the 80s, and they did reruns in the 90s of the $25,000 and $100,000 Pyramid. Dick Clark used to host it, and but at that point, I made it through the first game, and at that point it was almost midnight, and everyone's like, we're tired, let's head back to the hotel. So, this just came to my brain. We did go to one panel, day one, and we did briefly mention it. We went to the Omegathon round one. That was perfection. For those of you out there who do not know what the Omegathon is, it's a competition, and you sign up for it when you go to buy your passes.
Only qualification to be entered is you say, hey, I want to enter, and then they randomly pick people.
So it's 32 people, and you get paired up, and you have four rounds of competition, and the winner gets an all-expense-paid trip to Germany, or what I call Germany's version of E3. I forget what it's called, because I think they changed the name of it. It used to be called the Germany Game Show. Now it's something
else.
Is
this the Leipzig? Leipzig?
Yeah.
Okay.
But anyway, I just call it Germany's version of E3. So, the four rounds is a different game. And it could be a board game. It could be a video game. It could be a game that requires no skill at all. But the first three rounds are known to the general public and to the Omeganauts. The first round was Perfection. The board game Perfection that we all played when we were five.
I love that.
Pop goes Perfection.
And so, every time the board popped up and, you know, brought about somebody's doom, you'd have this, like, Greek chorus in the front of the panel room that would just scream, Pop goes Perfection! And it was funny the first 500 times.
Brian, that story goes up, the number goes up by 100 every time you tell that story.
Yes!
I just want you to be aware of that.
Yes!
That's like how everyone yelling Space Team was so funny by the end of the last PAX.
As a space team! Okay, no, we're done. We're done.
Yeah, 9 billion times later was as a space team. So, the second and third rounds I didn't go to, but that's, you know, day two and three. I did go to the final round, which we'll get to later. So if anyone else has anything to say on day one, let's hear it. If not, we'll go to day two, and then we will, during the day two chat, I think we will cut to break.
Let's see. This is more of a weekend-wide thing, but I actually did something a little bit interesting. And I brought a case of Cards Against Humanity cards, blank ones. And every time I met a developer I liked or met someone I knew from the internet, I told them to just think of a card on the spot. I'm not sure if I could say any on this show, but there were some pretty good ones.
That's actually a really cool idea.
Yeah, actually, I have a photo of it up on my recap on Sprites and Dice. But Tommy Riffinez of Team Meat probably had the sickest one.
There are no filters on this show. Go right ahead.
Oh, okay. All right, let's see.
This is not a family show.
I have to remember the wording because it was very precise. Let's see. Being aroused by the thought of your father masturbating on your fourth grade yearbook.
Oh, wow.
Whoa, okay.
Yep.
Well, remember, it is a game for horrible people. So,
I think he won the convention on that one.
I would think so. So,
oh.
On that happy note, we'll shift to day two.
Actually, I do have one other story, and I don't think anyone else was there with me that's on the convention. Oh, sorry, in the podcast right now. But I managed to break the convention within an hour and a half.
Oh, right! Yes!
Oh my god, yes. Please tell this story. This was
okay.
Phenomenal.
So, one thing you have to look out for if you ever go to a convention, this is just a public service announcement, is always look out for two things. One, the special events that might happen outside of the convention, like when a certain games group goes, well, we're going to throw a concert at a bar, you know, during the show hours or after show hours, you should come to it, or things like that. The other thing is the games that happen at the convention where mini games kind of get set up. A really good example of this would be where they were really, really kind of small. Was back in 2011, like Puzzle Quest 2 had one where pretty much if you got it, you got a different symbol for like one of the gems in the game, and it was a button. If you wore the button and you ran around, you got enough people, so you had one of like every single button type or like one other person that matched your button type exactly, you could come back and you would get like a small little like bonus, like a small little takeaway toy or something like that. There is one for a game, State of Decay. If you like zombie games, I would really highly recommend it because it's a really cool zombie survival game. It's done by a pretty small group that really brought it all together. And I really enjoyed going there because I saw them there. And they had a bigger booth, and they were still setting up. And I walk up there, and this one guy turns to me and goes, "Are you a medic?" And I go, "Excuse me? What?" And so then, like, three other guys turn and look at me like, "Are you a medic? We need you to be a medic." And I'm like, "No, I'm a Boy Scout. I don't know what you're talking about." And it turns out that what happened was that after you play the demo for State of Decay, the whole thing is about, like, you know, surviving the zombie apocalypse and having an enclave of people to do it with. And after you played the game, you picked a little tag out of a hat, and it had a job description for you. And what the mini game was that if you found six people with different jobs and they all got together, you could form an enclave and come back to the developers. And you could have from 6 to 10 people in this enclave, and if all the requirements were met, you'd all get a free copy of the game. Now this sounds really, really awesome. And apparently medics were in short supply. So I'm with my friends Alton and Jen, and we all kind of line up and we play the game, and it's awesome. And so I get to be a I was a hunter. I was a warrior hunter, which is one of the three classes you needed. And Jen got to be a construction worker, which is one of the other three classes you needed. But neither of us got medics. Alton actually became a high school jock, which he just kept saying, "I was the best in the city in my day." Like, that's all he said the rest of the convention. And we're running around trying to... We're playing the game, we're waiting, and then these guys all wander off. And this one kid gets in line behind me, and he's like, "Oh, you know, I don't want to get in line for games because I don't have money to buy them." And I tell him about this event, and he draws medic. And so I look at him, and I'm like, there's the prize. It's right there in front of me. And this kid gets medic, and like the developers of the game, the president of the game, and like their community director telling him, "Look, that is really valuable. Get yourself a group." And he kind of like takes the slip and starts hiding in his pocket because he's too shy. And so I'm sitting there going, "All right, someone's got to do this." So I go up to the kid, go, "Hey, you want a team? I have everyone else you need right here." And I feel really shady doing this, but I'm like, "Okay, we have your warrior, we have your construction worker, we have a high school jock, and then there was another guy in line who was like a waiter." And so we grab him too. And we go up to the developers like, "Hey, look, we've got everyone we need. We have, and they're like, "No, you need one more person." I'm like, "Come on, you've got to be kidding me." Meanwhile, a couple had just appeared behind us, and they both draw out of the hat. And one of them gets to be, I think they were like a parasailer. I forget what they were. And the other person is also a paramedic. So now there's suddenly two medics in line, and this couple doesn't want to get separated. So I go, "Well, we have seven people," and there was no one else around that was listening to me, and I kept looking around for those guys who were asking where we were. I'm like, "Well, too bad for them. We're going to survive. We're going to survive the zombie apocalypse together as a team, and we have two medics. So that way, if one of them dies, the other one can survive. So, Jim, I mean, you're useful, but Bob," and we started assigning, like, fake names and everything. And the community director comes up and goes, "Are you sure you want to do this?" And I'm like, "Yes, we want to live, damn it, it's the zombie apocalypse." At which point, like, "We need to take a picture." And they take a picture of the seven of us, and they say, "You now know that once you sign that this is your enclave, no one else can join or leave." I'm like, "Yeah, that's fine. We're going to survive together." Finds out right after that apparently for every day of the convention, they only had 4 medic tags. And we had promptly, within about the first hour and a half, blown through 2 of them in the exact same group. And not even tagged them all.
Well done.
What? And I'm sitting there, and I'm just like, "Welp. Every man for themselves, I'm the alpha dog." At which point, the people at the development booth were just laughing hysterically at what we had just done to everyone else.
"Congratulations, you now hoard 50% of the medics."
Oh, the funniest thing is I went back at the end of Friday night just to talk to them, and apparently the other medics didn't come out until literally the last draws of the night back-to-back.
Wow.
So I was very pleased with that. And I got a free game.
Meanwhile, Wyatt is going through the entire convention.
Yes.
That's typical for him, though.
No, that is, actually. So, you know what? I think I'm going to call this first half right there. Because now that we've had a nice bedtime story...
Sorry.
We'll take a break here. And then we'll swing into day two and three. Because I assume that especially by day three is probably a blur to most of us. So.
Oh, yeah.
So, on that happy...
Week's kind of a blur to me. The weekend.
So, on that happy note, we will cut to break. You'll have a few minutes of music. And we'll talk more about our experiences at this year's PAX East. You're listening to Downloadable Content. We'll be back. Welcome back to Downloadable Content, talking about PAX East 2014. Along the way, during the intermission, we seem to have lost two people. Ben and Jon both bowed out because, you know, it's getting... We're getting old, and, you know, 9 p.m., it's almost our bedtime. So, or they died of dysentery, one or the other. That'll happen, so it is... Now left, we have Doug, Wyatt, and Shanna.
Still here.
Still here, yeah. So well, I got a little more bandwidth back, so...
Not dead yet.
Not dead yet! Stone dead in a moment! So, after that wonderful story to close out the first half of Wyatt hoarding all the medics...
All of them.
Every single medic. We're going to go to Saturday, probably the busiest day of the convention.
Yeah, it definitely was.
Well, you definitely... I mean, I took pictures all 3 days, and just... Saturday, you had such a noticeable, much larger presence, especially trying to wade through the expo floor.
Mm.
One thing I did notice is that I was very grateful that more people used deodorant this year. It seemed.
yeah.
It just seemed like that. But once again, I navigated the expo floor, the indie booth, to have a look at, you know, some other games. A couple of games that stood out to me on the second day. One was Throw Trucks with Your Mind.
Yes.
I wanted to try that. How seemed, was
you
it?
Didn't?
Shanna, I didn't
of all the
to.
People, why did you not try this game?
Because she was too busy at that DDR looking.
Crypt of the NecroDancer was amazing, okay?
Oh, I wish I got a chance to try that game.
Yeah, I wanted to try that one so bad.
Well, Shanna,
that was super fun.
Shanna, since you didn't get in on the day one when we were talking about indie games that we saw, I ran into you at that game, so tell us a bit about it.
Well, this just proves my dedication to playing this game, because when you ran into me, I didn't get to play at that point. I took my little, because like they were basically giving you little tickers like you're waiting for lunch meat, you know what I mean? And I had one of those, and the wait was too long, and we were like trying to get around to do other things, so I'm like, all right, I'm going to have to come back. And I ended up going back. I actually didn't end up going back until Sunday, I guess, jumping ahead a little bit. But it basically, it's a basic dungeon crawl, but you have to use a DDR pad to get to where you're going, and you have to step in rhythm. And there's like this pulsing background music going the whole time, which actually, if you waited around long enough, it actually kind of changed genre, so it wasn't just like electro or techno the whole time. Like, it would all of a sudden be a metal song, and then like at one point there was a reggae song. Like, it was pretty awesome. And like the little dude in the item shop sings opera. Like, so you get near the item shop, and there's this little dude with music notes next to his head going, "Oh, it's amazing."
Oh,
so yeah, that game.
Oh, Maria.
I mean, yeah, it was pretty amazing, and it's all like 16-bit. It's super cute. There's little dancing, like, you know, skeletons and whatnot. It's just, it was super fun.
Oh, that's like one of the games I got to try on Friday in the indie area was on. I think the group's called Disco Pixel, and the game they had is I really hope I get the name right. It's like Jungle Rumble. And the best way I can describe it is it's like Patapon meets an RTS. And it was just, you know, like, you're getting, like, your monkeys to move while you, like, tap them in rhythm. It's like, you know, a phone game. I think it's going to be an iOS and Android. And you have to tap them in rhythm to get them to move and to, like, attack, you know, and move across the game board. It was crazy. it was so much fun, but it was, like, it was weird because, like, I was definitely like, I've never played this game before, so I gotta learn it, but I'm picking up on what it is, and it's just so different because it's combining kind of two strategies that you're not quite used to.
You are correct. It is called Jungle Rumble.
Mm-hmm.
It is by Disco Pixel. So, I'm very, very curious, though, Shane, about the game that you played, because, you know, now you're incorporating DDR mechanics into a story.
It was basically like, I mean, I didn't see any real, like, storyline elements to it, but, you know, you're only playing a demo, but it was basically like a dungeon crawl game. Like, it was like playing a Zelda game with your feet. And, like, you would have to, like, if you got near an enemy, you just had to keep tapping in that direction with your foot until you killed the enemy.
And suddenly you became Lord of the Dance.
It was pretty awesome. I mean, me and the fiancé played, and we had a blast.
And it, but getting back to throw trucks with your mind,
yeah,
I was watching Ben play it. You wear a headset. It's actually, and I was chatting to the developer, said, what is, it measures your brain waves. So basically, you know, it's a game where you can be a Jedi, essentially. And it's, the device that you wear on your head is a voltmeter, and it measures your brain waves. And, Ben was playing it, and he was, you know, having good concentration, and measured that. And the developer was trying to break his concentration by whispering sweet nothings in his ear. It didn't work. But it is. The entire mechanic is you use your mind to throw shit. And it's the title, you know. Throw trucks with your mind.
And advertising.
Yes, and... You know, I know Wyatt played this. I was told, though, that when Alton tried the game, the calm meter shot through the roof.
Absolutely.
Because Alton is like the Zen master of everything.
For those of you that don't know Alton, Alton is a very tall man that always has a very... You know those, that one friend you have that always sounds monotone? So, when they say that they're excited about something, that's like, yeah, no, I had a good time. And, like, that's, like, an ecstatic moment. That's what this man is. And he, like, you know, he does meditation at night and all that and keeps himself that way. And for the game itself, if you're not familiar, to kind of give it perspective, if you know what Team Fortress 2 is, imagine, like, a Team Fortress 2 kind of, like, deathmatch arena, but instead of you having guns,
you just have two bars and 8 psychic powers. One measures your focus, and the other one measures your calm. And a lot of the powers are linked to one or the other. So depending on how well your brain waves generate them, they both fill up on either side of kind of your targeting reticle. And then you can use these things like picking up the large spiked balls that are around the room, like almost like the ends of maces, and throwing them at people. Or, like cardboard boxes or wooden boxes, and just tossing them or like picking them up and running underneath them or turning invisible temporarily. So it was a really interesting mechanic, and kind of mixing that idea of... well, a whole new way how to play, but yet still having that competitive feeling to it. I know that my soon-to-be father-in-law actually knows games like this that are done in a psychologist. I can't say that word.
Psychologist,
thank you. Damn it to hell. Psychologist's office. Where...
so says the English major.
You shut up. The psychologist's office, where you would do something called biofeedback, where you're purposely trying to... you put, like, two bars on a screen or otherwise, and you're trying to make them so they level out just at the right amount. And what you're doing in this game is you're actually trying to keep yourself in a calm, focused state in order to have the most optimal way of killing people. So it's, like, a really interesting way of, like... you're almost actually doing a little bit of brain training while you're playing the game. I got, like, 15 minutes with the game, which is awesome, but I'd like to run it for a few hours to see those effects and see what else it measures.
Yeah. Another game that stood out to me on the second day, and I talked to the developers, over at Ten Wall Creatives, they're making a game. I don't know if any of you saw Bleak?
No, I missed that
didn't
one.
I didn't see that one.
It is a 2D RPG that incorporates a lot of post-apocalyptic and steampunk ideas. It also absorbs ideas from classic literature like Grimm's Fairy Tales, Arabian Nights. So a lot of blending of old children's stories, fairy tales, things like that. According to their website, they are in the middle of working on this game. Now, they had a playable demo at PAX. They are working on releasing this game in the next year or two. When I was speaking to them, it's on Steam Greenlight now. So if people want to go and greenlight it and then have a look to see what the game is about, because it will have controller support, which is a plus for me, because I don't want that keyboard mouse thing. That's just weird and strange.
Yeah,
and foreign.
I'm never gonna get used to that. But did anybody do anything like for like some of the like the AAA and like kind of the big, you know, the big companies, kind of the forefront stuff? Because I actually tried to make a point of doing that on Saturday, and I stood in one line for 2 hours to watch somebody else play an unfinished copy of the new Borderlands, but I kind of wanted to get that experience. And it was interesting, to say the least.
I typically, when I go to PAX, I don't typically pay attention to the AAA stuff, because that's the stuff I hear about already on a regular basis.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. You're going to get bombarded by the news and everything like that. But I mean, it was, like, on one hand, like, yeah... like, the actual, like, kind of dome they had set up, like, had, like, some form of, like, almost air conditioning in it, and, like, really comfortable seats that reclined. On the other hand, I stood in line for 2 hours to watch someone else play a game. So, it was interesting, and, I mean, they had that whole, the whole passport thing where it's like, okay, you watched the demo, you took your picture with the statue we've got, and if you go to this other booth, they come back and we'll give you like a little goodie bag. So I mean, I kind of made a point to just do that once, but it's like overall, I think it's not to sound cruel to any of the game companies, but it's kind of a waste of your time.
It honestly depends on the company. For example, I actually decided for once I was going to get there really early on Friday, so I was there like an hour early. or a little bit more than that, I waited on that giant line, which is an experience on itself. You should do it at least once.
Oh, the big queue line? It's amazing.
Yeah. where all of a sudden there's 30 beach balls, and they just start spawning, and everyone's just back and forth.
But oh, so basically it's a Dave Matthews concert.
Well, it turns out, like, at some point, someone releases just one. And all of a sudden you look up, and there's four. And it just gets worse and worse.
So a Dave Matthews concert.
I suppose. Now, the thing is about it was that I decided, okay, the first day we kind of planned this out. Like, what do we want to go see first? Pasita, this, that. And we had gotten up pretty early in the queue line. And we decided we're going to go to Ubisoft because we really like the idea of Watch Dogs. And we heard that there was going to be a demo. So I get in line with my group, and we run all the way there. And we get to the Watch Dogs. We ask the Ubisoft people, where's the Watch Dogs line specifically? And they, oh, here it is. And we get on it, and there's a short wait of like 15, 20 minutes, or not even, like 10, 15. And once we get on the line, we go up there, and it's just a computer screen, and there's like a ring of them, and you log onto your Facebook, and then it does the whole thing where it does a scan saying, we're watching you, we're always here, we're just, you know, pretty much doing like a whole like pseudo ARG. Hey, look, you know, this is a hacking game, and we know how to hack your stuff. Watch what you put on Facebook, and they gave you some pins. And I was like, really? That's it? And some of them can be really huge letdowns, where you just watch someone play the game, or you see a small, tiny demo, and there's nothing really that you get out of it. Now, on the other hand, there's other games which you get a lot out of, and I could pick a few from last year, but I'll pick the one game that I wasn't expecting to even see. I didn't know about it until PAX, which was called Lichdom. Did anyone else wait on that line?
We almost did. We did end up getting one of the awesome t-shirts.
T-shirts are amazing. Yeah, with Neil the shirts are the ones that have Neil deGrasse Tyson on it going, hey, we got ourselves a real badass over here. And he has fireballs. It's like the meme. And it's fantastic. I got a shirt from my friend for that one. And I'm like, okay, we need to see this game. And we get in there. And it's a game about a first-person shooter where you are a mage that's supposed to feel like a real badass, which is why they have the shirt like that. And so it's a first-person shooter mage game with really high-end graphics, and you do sit down and you play the demo, and you see the developer. You have the game designer giving a narration, and they have one guy playing through the game, and he's trying to get through as long as he can while you're in this room, and they give away at least one free beta key to every single group that goes in there. And if he gets through without dying, he gives away another one. And they kind of like do this sort of like game with themselves to see if they can manage it. But afterwards, they let you out, and they have an area in the back where they had about, I'm going to say, 20 to 25 computers that were in a walled-off section with developers sitting there like one or two per like two or three computers, and be able to answer questions, help you learn how to play the game. And you got to play for like 10, 15 minutes in quiet and just enjoy yourself if you wanted to. So that was awesome and totally worth it. It's totally a mixed bag.
Yeah, that actually, like, that experience actually sounds really cool. And that's it's once again that it's like we keep talking about this, it's that community of when you actually get to talk and interact with the people and get a bit of their time.
That's always a lot of fun.
I'll toss in one thing. I had one of my friends who's a big cosplayer, which, yeah, it's not really what you do at PAX, but she wore a League of Legends costume. I think it was Heimerdinger is the name of the character, and she was cosplaying him. Like, she apparently walked by the Riot booth, and like five people, like from the team, like freaked out to see her.
Say what you will about League of Legends, their booth at PAX is like one of the perfect AAA game booths in some ways. Why? Well, they're not showing off anything new. They're just showing off more of their game, which is pretty much like one of the esports by this point. But in each one of these little sections, they have the artists, they have the game developers, they have the community managers, and they all play the game. They all have their name, their call sign on the backs of their shirts, and they're handing out the free skins that are only available at PAX, and they're handing out lanyards. But before you get them, you have to tell them about who your favorite character is, do your favorite characters dance in front of them, and you actually kind of get this like this great little small mini communities going. They have events, and they have contests, and they have the games going up on their booth in this just large open arena. And it's just really cool to see that, where, again, they might be a large, very huge name. And again, I remember back in 2011, they were like tacked onto another booth just with a few people. And now here they are with so many individuals just sitting there wanting to hear the other members and ask, what is your favorite character? What do you think about the game? what do you think, what was the one thing you'd do to change it? And they were, I'd hear them asking these questions, and it was fantastic to just experience that.
Mm-hmm.
It opens up the dialogue with fans. I mean, that's exactly what a fan would want, you know what I mean? That sounds like it's the ultimate experience to be able to put in your two cents and to actually be able to interact with the people who made this game that you fell in love with.
Yeah, it's both sides. It's treat the people like a human being and you'll get a much better response out of them. You know,
and you'll get much loyal players that, you know,
yeah,
that will keep paying for your service, quite frankly.
Basically, I mean, one of the highlights of my day on that Saturday was I was at the Behemoth booth. And I ended up getting a poster and having it signed by Tom Fulp and Will Stamper. Tom Fulp is one of the programmers for the Behemoth games, Alien Hominid, Castle Crashers, Battle Block Theater. He also founded Newgrounds. That's his baby. Stamper is the voice of the narrator on Battle Block Theater.
It's a secret.
And you know, I took out my poster, and it's the Castle Crashers poster that looks like one of the Obama campaign posters.
All right.
And it says, "Hope you like it." And Stamper and Tom just start doodling on the poster.
Nice.
They just start. It's not just they didn't sign it. They're doodling all over it, and you know. And, you know, Stamper is just as much of a wacko in the game as he is in real life. He doesn't give a shit. and it was just, he was going on, you know, bantering like this with everybody in the line. Somebody, the person ahead of me had a poster, and it had a noticeable crease from folding it. And so Stamper then takes one of the markers and he fills in this crease with silver Sharpie and then writes next to it in parentheses, "Fixed."
I'm just trying to go through in my mind of other stuff I did on Saturday. Like, I finally got to go through the tabletop when stuff was open and see more of that. And that was, you saw a lot more people, like, even if they weren't the person, like, behind the games, just saying, "Hey, I've got this game, who wants to try it out?" And that's what was one of the neater things to see going on. I mean, I got to try a little bit of, like, the one game called Slash, which is basically Cards Against Humanity meets the most crazy fan fiction parodies, pairings you can make. Like, the pitch the guy gave me was, who would be better for the 50-foot woman, the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man or Bigfoot? But you actually, you know, you could really try a lot of that stuff, and, you know, even if it, like I said, if it wasn't somebody marketing it, it was just, "Hey, I have a fun game," or, "Hey, I just bought this, I want to try it out." And grabbing anybody who was interested was really neat to see.
I did notice that. I mean, well, obviously, in answer to your question, the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man, that's, you know, it's a no-brainer. But, you know, a lot of people that were there, I mean, I was playing a lot of a game that Wyatt introduced me to. I was playing Boss Monster.
Yes.
That seemed to be the game du jour of the weekend, and I converted Ben to it.
A very successful Kickstarter that just...
Yep, I converted Doug, I converted Ben. It was just... Because I also bought the expansion.
You were one of the lucky ones that could find it.
Well, that's because I bought it on day one. I bought the game and the expansion on day one. That was the first thing I bought while I was at PAX. Friday was my get all of my purchases out of the way day, because I knew that by time we get to Saturday and Sunday, there'd be slim pickings.
Yeah.
So
I picked up one thing on Friday, but yeah, stuff was already starting to dwindle by Saturday.
So, That was mostly my day. I did not go to any panel on Saturday. Did any of you?
I kind of did, and then after this story, I'm going to have to bow out. But I didn't go to a panel per se. I was planning on it, but there was this one game called Grey Goo, and it wasn't a indie game per se. It was one of the smaller kind of large development groups, which is a weird mixture. But what was great about them is that it was an RTS on the floor. I'm like, well, hey, I haven't seen one of these in a while. And I wait online for the game, and I think it's a small line just at the end of Friday. And I go to play the game and end up talking to someone next to me, and I don't get a lot of time with the game because it's right as the show floor is closing, right? So I get in there, and I teach this one person how to play next to me more than I get a chance to play the game. But I end up talking to the developer, one of the people that was the community managers and the community director, and I give them my card, and I say I'm a really big fan of this sort of game, and we'd love to cover it because we don't see a lot of RTSs. And we're very small, and I start telling them that. They're like, wait a second, no, come talk to our community manager. And they give me two wristbands. And they're like, well, we're having a party from 7 to 10 tomorrow on Saturday. We'd love for you to come join us. And I'm like, well, okay, this feels nifty. I finally got invited to one of those parties I was telling people about during that first section. And me and John drive out there. We're not expecting it because we find out that it's at a bar like 3 miles out from the convention center. And we're like, we've never done this before. What should we expect? And we find out that we end up going to this awesome bar in the back where it's a meet and greet with the developers. And they're out there, and you know, they had free food and appetizers just everywhere in here. And they just had the developers of the game walking around playing pool in this bar-like setting and talking to people. And I talked to a lot of people that were just huge fans of real-time strategy games, and they have been for years. And I ended up meeting the guy, Frank, who had done the music for Lands of Lore for all of the Command & Conquer series and Red Alert. He was the guy who did all the music to that set. And I found out that the company behind Grey Goo, a lot of the original developers, were the developers from Westwood Studios, if anyone remembers that company. And it was just really, really cool to do that, to see this. Yeah, right? I mean, if you recognize the name, either you know it or you don't. But if you know it, you have fond memories of being a lot younger and playing through these games that helped found a lot of the games we now play out there, you know, like Dune 2 and the Red Alert series. And it was just really great hearing how this guy had come up with all the music in his garage, or, you know, how, you know, the stories of how he did this one or the other, or one of the main developers or designers of the game, how when he was originally working for Westwood Studios, how they met with George Lucas about, you know, the possibility of working with LucasArts, and like all these like stories you wouldn't hear otherwise. So again, going back to community, and again, conventions are great for it. I would highly recommend, if you ever have not gone to PAX or any other large-scale convention, go for it. And when it comes to PAX, it's definitely the one that I feel like is geared most towards the gamer itself. So, yeah, I appreciate it. Thanks for letting me ramble.
Yeah, I mean, I'll toss in just kind of my, you know, one story party I went. I ended up, that was one of the things that I kind of made a point of going to on Saturday night is, kind of a friend of a friend works for one of the kind of vendors that does, you know, various geeky t-shirts and everything. I think it's Sanchi. And they you know, had a party and everything like that. And, you know, while it was, you know, neat to see friends, there was also a lot of people that I just kind of got out of my shell a little bit and talk to people. I'm like, hey, these people also like the geeky stuff that I like. Let's go talk to them. And yeah, you're getting away from the convention site proper, but at the same time, you're interacting with more fellow fans, and that is really kind of what drives, you know, a good convention experience, is the interaction you'll have with fellow fans.
Yes, the PAX and then the after PAX. Dun-dun-dun.
Well, yeah, I mean, and they had, like, one of the best weekends to do it as Boston started doing the late-night train service.
Absolutely. That was great.
Oh.
So, if anyone else has anything about panels and whatnot for the second day, then say so. If not, we're going to go into the Saturday night concerts.
The last thing I'll toss in before... that was one of the other things I picked up was I went to the Fangamers booth, and, you know, another vendor, and I was finally able to get the collection of stuff by Zach Gorman, his kind of art style, Magical Game Time, which if you haven't checked out, definitely do. I mean, he captures a lot of just kind of the fun imagination between a lot of the Super Nintendo era of video games and stuff like that. And then I tweeted at him, but I didn't get a reply. I was hoping to see if he was actually at the con himself, because I would have talked the guy's ear off and probably begged him to draw me a war turtle, because that's what I get at every convention. But yeah, I mean, it's that, I know we keep bringing it up with the community.
Absolutely. All right, I'm getting word from Wyatt that he has to bow out. So
I do. I held it as long as I could.
Thank you very much, Wyatt, for jumping on.
Thanks for having me. Thanks for listening to me ramble. Again, love PAX. Fantastic. Lots of articles on spritesanddice.blogspot.com. Hurrah.
So go check it out.
Yes. Bye.
All right, see ya.
Bye.
Later.
And then there were three.
It's like we're dropping like flies. What's going on?
Yeah, well, you know, again, we're all old, and so, you know, now it's after 9 o'clock, and, you know, the Geritol needs to kick in. It's so on and so forth. So, moving into Saturday night, the concerts. Ben and I, now, for me, the performers for Saturday night in order went the Double Clicks, which is a female duo. Then MC Frontalot, white and nerdy rapper, and Video Game Orchestra, which for me that's the biggest draw. Video Game Orchestra. I know, Doug, you've seen them.
Mm-hmm.
Though they're based in Boston. I'd have to slap you if you hadn't. But be that as it may, Ben and I parked ourselves just out in front of the main theater because Ben was now addicted to the tabletop game Boss Monster. For those of you who haven't played it, let me just give you a brief summary. You play as an 8-bit boss monster from an 8-bit RPG. You have to build a dungeon for heroes who wander into town to go through. And your goal is to kill 10 heroes before they can inflict 5 points of damage to you. That's basically the premise. So, it was Ben, myself, and Ryan in this game. And, you know, we had some nice background music going on. We had the Double Clicks going on. I could hear them very well. And then later, MC Frontalot. And Ben was at 9 points. He was at game point, and he was there for a long time. But over the course of play, Ryan ended up getting knocked out, so it was just Ben and I, and there were all of these thieves in town. 7 of them, to be exact, because neither Ben or I had more thief lures, more thief treasures than the other. And we had run out of heroes now. So the only people that were left were these 7 thieves wandering aimlessly about town going, which dungeon do we go to? And the score. And so Ben had 9, I had 6. So I'm like, you know what? MC Frontalot is wrapping up soon. Video Game Orchestra is going to go on. And I really want to see Video Game Orchestra. So I am going to break the tie. I am going to build a room to my dungeon which are going to allow all the thieves to come to me. Which means that either I am going to be destroyed in the most spectacular fashion, or I'm going to have the most dramatic bottom of the ninth rally ever. Because keep in mind, you need 10 hero souls to win. Ben had been stuck on 9 for about 30 minutes. So I'm like, all right, fine. I'm going to break the tie. I now have more thief treasures than Ben. All the thieves come to me. And to make a long story short, of the 7 thieves, I kill 6 of them. one of them hits me, not enough to kill me, I win the game 16-9.
Nice.
And I'm like, I knew either I was going to be so horribly splayed or win in the most dramatic fashion. And that was the longest and most epic game of boss monster I have played ever.
Yeah, but the thing I noticed about that game is it seems daunting when you first set it up, but it is very easy to pick up.
Oh yeah, I mean the initial layout looks confusing as all hell, but once you get the rules, it just moves.
Mm-hmm.
It just moves. And you know, the first time I was showing it to Ben and Ryan, I mean, it says even in the rules, it says, you know, the first playthrough is going to be about 45 minutes, and then after that, it just moves. So, but anyway, that was the boss monster story. We move into the concerts. Again, I had heard, I was listening to the first two outside the main theater, and I had gone in for Video Game Orchestra. Now, Shen, I know you were boozing it up at this point, so you weren't there.
I was boozing it up and starving at the same time at a Chinese restaurant. So, it wasn't. I didn't mean to be starving. It was basically, you know, short story. We're out with like probably about 15. Me and my, you know, fiance are out with about 15 people who were running the Sentinels of the Multiverse booth. We're friends with a couple guys over there. So we go to this Chinese restaurant, and funny enough, being the nerds we are, after looking at the extensive drink menu, the only way that we could decide what drinks we want is by rolling a 20-sided. That's how everybody at the table. That is how every single person at the table figured out what they were drinking that night. So, anyways, you know, we all order our food, and John and I watch everybody get their food other than us, and we ask the waiter probably about 3 or 4 times that night, you know, like, hey, we don't have our food. Everyone else is eating. We don't have our food. And eventually we just get to the point where, like, can you just box it up or take it off the bill? And then they just give us a bill without our food on it. So we just boozed and didn't eat all night. That's why I missed Video Games Orchestra.
Doug, were you present for VGO?
No, I had gone to the that party by that point. But, I mean, I've seen them perform before. And they do a great show. I mean, I was hearing stories of people like shouting out random songs and they pick it up.
Well, yeah, basically, you know, because they were the last to go on, which basically meant they had all the time in the world to do their set. So, in between songs, you know, it's the audience, so they're shouting out random songs. And, you know, somebody's like, yeah, Freebird! And they start, you know, going into Freebird. And, you know, then they start going into other songs. Like, there was, like, AC/DC.
Oh, jeez.
But in between the shenanigans, you know, I'm looking at the set list right now because I just pulled it up. They did a total of 9 songs. They opened up with Liberi Fatale from Final Fantasy VIII. Then they went the Snake Eater.
Oh wow, that must have been amazing to hear live.
That was. Then they went into a medley from the game Super Hexagon. Then they gave control to the silver-haired pianist, who then did a medley of Sonic 2.
What? I missed that.
Yes, you did.
Damn! I'm so upset.
Then, I will tell you this right now, and I will tell the entire internet this. Twitch TV broadcast most of the panels at PAX, including the concerts. So if you missed them, they are on Twitch.
Good to know.
So, in probably much better audio quality than I heard it, because I had, you know, loud metal and bass and, you know... Although the sound guy finally figured out that you need to, how to, you know, make the chorus actually heard. So they went into Sonic 2, then they did a Zelda medley, and then they did a song from Skyrim. One of the songs that you hear in any bar or tavern you go to called The Dragonborn Comes.
Oh, that's cool.
Then that they did a song that they did last year. They went into this from F-Zero called Big Blue.
Mm-hmm.
Now, last year at PAX, they did a thing where the four guitarists came to the front of the stage. And now, Big Blue, if you've ever heard it or have played on the board from Super Smash Brothers, the song is very fast. Yeah. So they decided to show off last year by, in the middle of the song, they start crossing arms and playing each other's guitars.
Oh, sick. Are you serious?
That was last year. Now, Alton and I were next to each other watching this, and we knew, and we look at each other and go, they're going to do the thing. So then, during the song, we think that, because all four guitarists come to the front of the stage again, and we think they're going to start playing each other's guitars again. No, they one-up themselves. They turn around, backs to the audience, put their guitars behind their heads, and start and play.
Nice.
That can't be human.
And Alton and I are just screaming like fangirls. The only time you'll ever see Alton not in his zen-like state. So that was amazing. And then after that, they did a song from Sonic Unleashed called "Endless Possibility," and they closed with a song called "Zombies on Your Lawn" from Plants vs. Zombies.
Yeah.
Which was great, because I thought, and because this is a common concert closer for them, is Still Alive from Portal. So I'm glad they changed it up. So, but in that said, they were just doing a lot of shenanigans and fooling around, which was great. It was a great show. And so then I caught up with the group on the third day. I guess we'll go into the third day now, because unless anyone else did anything after that, because coming back from PAX that night, we ran into a slightly boozy Shanna and Jon.
Well, you have to understand, this was after the Chinese restaurant by the time you saw us, and we ended up heading back to the Westin, which we weren't staying there, but we had a friend staying there. And we, you know, got into a big game of Flux, and the bar happened to be open down there all night, and they happened to have, like, special PAX drinks.
Yeah.
So I was, after, you know, my night of boozing at the Chinese restaurant, I started drinking D&D Delights over a game of Flux.
I mean,
so yeah, I was in a good mood by the time they ran into me.
I mean, you bring up one point, though. I mean, that's the one thing about that area, is like, other than like the Westin and the, you know, a couple other things, I mean, the one downside is there's not a lot of like cheap, quick options for food, and that's like one of the few downsides to PAX East, is if you want something inexpensive to eat, you have to leave the area.
Yeah, I mean, luckily, the food prices are a bit high at the convention center, but
as they would be. I mean, anything of that ilk, they jack up the prices, because they know that, you know, it's either that or you have to leave.
Yeah,
so.
You know?
But I mean that's the one thing that just, I mean, the one kind of big complaint I heard from a lot of people was, you know, cheap food options. I mean, yeah, that food court there's arguably the best food court I've ever seen at a convention center, but it's still those prices, and it's so weird.
Yeah, I mean,
I know that Boston's talking about improving that area, but I hope that happens. That can't happen fast enough, and I think if PAX continues to, you know, get the numbers it's getting, they're going to see a greater need for it.
I think that's the case. I mean, especially since PAX East is going to be there for a while to come yet. So, but moving into the third day now, and you could tell it was the third day.
We have to tell the story about the lounge.
Yes, and you know, there on the second floor, there is a handheld lounge, and just before I go into that story, I did not see a single Vita or PSP. I saw so many 3DSs. I filled up most of my Street Pass map.
Yeah, oh, yeah. I think I might
pull up. I know I completed at least three puzzles. Like, the one they that was introduced over the weekend, I had like all but three pieces by the end of the weekend.
Yeah, it was just... But anyway, the Handheld Lounge is a place where, you know, they have these huge full-body pillows that you play on your handheld. By day three, the Handheld Lounge became the Nap Lounge. And if you check out my Facebook or Downloadable Contents Facebook, you'll see pictures up that I shot at PAX. And yeah, day three, and it's like, oh, look at the sleepy gamers.
If I had known about that, I would have like dug out like an old like Tiger handheld or something. Just
oh my god, how great would that be?
And just to see the reactions I'd get by playing it.
Like, you're old. Or break out like a Game and Watch.
Yeah, exactly.
Game Gear, and then have to get up like every 5 minutes to charge it.
Yeah. If you bring a Game Gear, at least bring 60 batteries.
Well, the one cool thing I'll say about that lounge, like, I wanted to go back to that lounge at some point, it just didn't happen, but I didn't realize that they actually had games, like, that you could quote-unquote rent. Like, I just thought it was like, okay, well, you have your own stuff, you plop down on a, you know, on a beanbag chair and just hang out there for a while, but they had, like, books at the front, and if you left your ID, you could borrow a game, and possibly, you know, a handheld console if they had it, and go and, like, test it out for a little while.
Oh, yeah, they did that with the, at the console free play as well. I finally got to play a game on a Wii U for the first time, and it was Super Smash Bros. Brawl. So, So yeah, I get to see the Wii U for the first time, and I'm playing a Wii game on it. So, like, myself, Ben, Wyatt, Jack, and then later Jen, we're in there for about an hour playing Super Smash Bros. But on the third day, I finally made it a point to do a couple of things. I went into the arcade free play and saw, you know, walked in and, you know, obviously felt right at home. And the biggest crowd was around the Fix-It Felix Jr.
Oh my god, yes! That was the one game, like, that was the very first game in the course of the weekend that I waited online for, was to play Fix-It Felix. I could not wait.
Well, it's the first game you see when you walk in. It's right...
And Turbo was right next to it.
Yes!
So I missed that there was a Turbo.
Yeah, it was right next to Fix-It Felix.
Oh, that's brilliant!
So we're going around, and, you know, I'm trying to find an arcade console to play. And Ryan and I end up, we get up playing Mario Brothers. Not Super Mario Brothers. The Mario Brothers where you have to, like, punch the ground to kill enemies, and then you kick them and you get coins and whatnot. It's the Mario Brothers with the POW block. So we played some of that. I got photographic evidence of Doug playing Missile Command.
I got to play Missile Command too. Oh. It was so fun.
And then we all were playing some pinball.
There was I've gone up to a Fun Spot in New Hampshire.
Oh, so have I.
Where all those games come from, because it's, you know, the whatever they call it, the museum there. But it's funny because, like, I for the first time I played the arcade version of Punch-Out. That was a surreal experience, because, like,
oh yeah,
I've gotten, you know, played the NES and Super NES versions of those a bunch of times, and I've gotten pretty good, and I was just getting my ass handed to me. And I'm like, why am I doing so bad? I know this game. It was just the arcade version controls were just different enough that it took me a bit to get used to it.
Yeah, not so much fun when it's not an NES, isn't it?
Yeah. So I was losing to Glass Joe. How do you do that?
Oh, I'm sorry.
like, thankfully I managed to come back, but if I had, like, lost to Glass Joe, I probably would have just, like, handed in my nerd card right then and there.
It's been like, Brian, take this. That's it. I'm going to go hang myself. That's it. I don't deserve this. But, you know, we got some arcade free play in, and yes, Fun Spot.
The one thing I definitely loved about the arcade room, it was the ambiance. I think that was the coolest thing. Because you walked in.
And everything, yes.
I mean, there was nothing but 80s music videos all over the wall. I mean, there was like Joan Jett, you know, Weird Al's like, Eat It. Like, you know, all this like nostalgic music, Michael Jackson. And then there was like on the back wall, they had like, there was like, you know, video clips of Dragon's Lair, which that was in there too. Dragon's Lair was in there. Lupin the Third. There was like video clips of Lupin the Third.
I can actually, I'm sorry to cut you off. That's the game Cliff Jumper. That's like, it's like Dragon's Lair or Space Ace. And uh-huh. It's actually, you know, that big CD-ROM game. And it uses clips from, like, two Lupin movies.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's so weird, like, because, like, you know, I'm an anime fan, so the first time I saw this, I was, like, so confused. But yeah, it's from the game Cliff Jumper.
Well, there you go.
So weird.
Interesting, good to know.
Yeah, once again, they have it up at Fun Spot. But if you look it up, it's the two Lupin the Third movies, Castle of Cagliostro and what's the other one? Secret of Mamo, which has see, finally my anime knowledge comes into play here. It had to happen eventually.
There you are. We got the crossover.
Sorry to cut you off, though.
Oh no, it's fine. I learned something.
Yeah,
and I was just having just such a blast in there. But after that, I spent some time. Now, there was a new thing at PAX this year, probably created in response as a result of some of the not-so-savory comments made by the Penny Arcade guys regarding, you know, people who are not straight. So they made what was called a diversity lounge. Doug, I don't know. I think you were there for a bit.
Yeah, that's where I finally got my my pone meal.
Yes, the diversity lounge was this pretty good sized room where there was booths and information regarding the LGBT community and gamers. Projects, information, and it was a very, very happening place.
Like, it was never packed, but it was never empty either. Like, people were genuinely going in to check it out, which was cool to see. And I'd love to hear kind of some of the reception from people running tables, like how the reactions they got and kind of the feedback they got.
Well, I asked somebody at one of the tables what the audience has been, because pre-PAX there was a lot of thinking that this was going to be the room where only, you know, the LGBT gamers were going to be, you know, just shove them all into a corner. And it didn't seem like that at all. I had asked one of the panelists who was there all weekend, and I said, you know, what's been the overall audience? Has it been, you know, have you had a lot of pushback or negative actions or anything like that? That, you know, she said no. You know, they've had, you know, a lot of LGBT gamers, obviously, but also a lot of straight people. So it was very, very nice to hear that, you know, there are people out there with open minds who were genuinely concerned and wanted to see what it was all about.
Yeah, and they, like, and that was, it was nice to see that response. I mean, there are definitely people I know who no longer attend PAX or refuse to ever go because they don't feel it's a safe space, and I can understand that. I mean, I'm white, straight male. I, you know, for me, I don't feel threatened, but I can understand their concern. And it was nice to see that while it shouldn't have happened for the reasons it did, I'm glad that it happened. And I think the best thing about it was they didn't try and force it on anyone. They just said, hey, this is a thing we're doing.
Yep.
It's here if you want to check it out. everybody's welcome, and I think that's the right approach to take with it. And once again, you know, we keep harping on this community thing, and that's the way to do it, is say, hey, these are part of our community too. If you want to be, come and feel included, here's a place you can go.
Absolutely.
Well, isn't that not the whole reason behind things like conventions and expos? I mean,
yeah,
obviously there's the whole of the marketing spin and the, you know, showing new demos of games or what have you. If it's a car expo, it's, you know, cars. But, like, it's also because it's a place to get together a community of like-minded individuals who are all passionate about the same things, in this case, gaming. So why not broaden that even more by saying, like, you know, why is there dissension in here against, like, you know, basically who you bring home with you at night? Like, that doesn't even matter. We're all sitting here picking up controllers and, or, you know, putting on our headphones and diving into our keyboards or whatever you do. That's what this is all about. None of that other stuff matters.
Mm-hmm.
So everyone should be able to just come in and game and be happy about it and not feel uncomfortable or threatened by anybody.
It was very, very nice to see, and I hope that, you know, they continue to improve upon it. I hope that, you know, I would like to have PAX, you know, be a safe place for all gamers, because I've always been of the opinion that video games as a medium, they are all inclusive, and they should be all inclusive, and, you know, that's the end of it.
Yeah, I mean, the one note I will take from this is I would actually like to see more conventions beyond PAX do something like that. And, you know, you'll have, like, some people might have a table in one area, but, you know, to kind of, and this might not be the right word for it, but spotlight it a little bit and really, you know, showcase, I guess would be the good way to put it, is say, this is something we're doing where we're trying to really encourage this part of the community because we think it's a conversation worth having and, you know, draw attention to the fact that we want everyone to feel included would be a really cool thing. Because there are plenty of people who have said, you know, I mean, it seems like every other week you hear someone talking about they went to this con and, you know, they were harassed because, oh, why are you cosplaying that character when, you know, you're not the same race as them? Or, you know, they're like, oh, you're just a fake geek girl, stupid things like that. And I'd rather see more of these safe places be created that really encourage everyone to have that dialogue and say at the end of the day, hey, we're all geeks for this stuff. It's more fun when everyone's on the same team and everyone's having fun together.
I definitely think it's a great start. I also definitely think that it needs to grow, and I also think that PAX needs to talk about that a bit more.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, this was the first year that they were doing it. You know, I thought it was a great start. Let's improve upon it. So
mm-hmm.
that was my take. So. Then we start moving toward the end of the con, the final round of the Omegathon, which is, you know, a state secret, practically. Yeah, as I mentioned in the first half, the first round was Perfection, the second round was a game called Starwall, the third round was Towerfall, the fourth round, which is the final round, it's now down to two teams of two at this point. I need to give you guys a little bit of a setup. If you were at PAX last year, the final round was an iPad game called Space Team. However, the final round was so fraught with technical failure. Because to play four players on that game, they set up their own private Wi-Fi for that game... that convention center sucks for bandwidth and for wireless on a good day. So, because they could not even complete a game last year, they just declared both teams the winners. So, This year, the question was, did they learn their lesson? Are we going to have another technically... another final round so full of fail? The final game, I initially thought, okay, they're going to go back to a console game. It doesn't require the Wi-Fi or anything like that. Because the first time I went to PAX in 2011, the final round was the video game Ikaruga. So, I'm like, okay. For this year's PAX, the final round, they didn't go high tech, they didn't go low tech, they went no tech. It was cornhole.
the game with the beanbags and, you know, trying to aim for the little hole in a wooden board, right?
Yeah.
It's so weird because on one hand I'm like, okay, they're really driving home the point of this is, you know, this isn't just a video game convention. This is a
game.
On the other hand, part of me is like, it almost feels like the well's starting to run dry, like they're running out of ideas. So it's that fine line.
I thought it was hilarious how you went from one polar extreme to the opposite. It was just like, all right, we're going to have a game in which we have no technical failure at all. A lawn game.
I'd love to see them go the route of, like, the Wizard, the old Fred Savage movie, and have it be the big reveal of Super Mario Bros. 3.
The whole audience was cracking up because, the game was announced, it was cornhole, and I'm like, wow, you're going to decide who gets to go to Germany on a beanbag toss.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yep. That's exactly what happened. And finally, after, the game was played. You know, I'm watching this, I'm like, this is probably like the PAX equivalent of curling. It's like, but 4,000 people in this theater, you know, are excited over this freaking lawn game. And I'm like, what, next year it's going to be jarts?
Oh, God. That just sounds dangerous.
Or something like that. It'll just, I don't know, bocce. But no, we had a winner, and you know, then the confetti exploded and the mic drop, and you know, that was game, set, and match for PAX East. So then we all took our very, very exhausted selves back home, and I still had a 30-minute subway ride and then a 3.5-hour drive home ahead of me.
Oh, so did we. Well, wait a minute. Did anyone else go to Acquisitions, Inc. by any chance? Did anyone see the live D&D game, or no?
No.
No.
I don't know. That was pretty fun. I mean, that's basically what it is. It's a live D&D game, and they've done this several times at PAX, and they tend to usually have, like, some sort of, celebrity guest. It's been Patrick Rothfuss before. They've had Will Wheaton do it a few times. This time it was Morgan Webb from X-Play, formerly of X-Play. So that was pretty fun. It was my first time watching it. So, like, I mean, I've seen, like, videos before. It's pretty funny. I mean, it's kind of like a comedic D&D game. But, you know, I got into it. It was pretty good. You got a pin for it too, so that was pretty cool.
Yeah. The one thing I will toss out that I will say about Sunday is, you know, we mentioned earlier how, you know, some of the stuff you had to wait in line for and everything like that. On the opposite side, Sunday is the day when a lot of people finally say, okay, we don't want to take all this stuff back home. So you start finding, you know, various vendors and stuff just like putting a box out in front of their booth and say, here, take one. Please. We want to get rid of them.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how I finally got my inflatable axe from one of those, that Viking game. That's how I got a bunch of the demo decks from Magic and things like that. So it's you know, the two extremes. If you want to really get the item, you'll have to go there, you know, go early. But, you know, if you're willing to just kind of get while the getting's good, and you know, it doesn't matter what it is... You're more apt to find that on Sunday. So, I mean, on one hand, I don't know if I'd go do all 3 days again. Like, if I go back, I'll do just Saturday. But, I mean, I definitely had a good time all 3 days.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, to put a wonderful to put a bow on it, it's again, I felt very, very much very comfortable. You know, Wyatt kept mentioning it, there's a real sense of community, and there is. You know, you're waiting on you're waiting in line for a panel, for example, and you know, tons of games spring up. You get initiated in the fine tradition of learning a new game. You know, that's how I learned how to play Flux. We didn't play test this at all, which is Flux on crack.
I actually know the developers for that game. That game's so much fun. They also have a win, loser, banana.
Yes, yes. It's a wonderful, wonderful venue, and you know I definitely find something to do all 3 days. You know, and I forgot to mention that I went to a panel on the third day, which was you know why The Legend of Zelda is just as important as The Legend of Beowulf.
How was that? Yeah, that one just sounds cool.
That was incredibly interesting. It was basically arguing how, you know, why these things are very important. And, you know, the long and the short of it was is because video games are an interactive medium, the game you play is your legend because you are the person interacting with the game. So the story is yours. You are living vicariously through this.
That's not at all what I was expecting, but that's a really cool point.
So that's the short Spark Notes version of that panel. I don't know if Twitch recorded that panel, but hopefully they did. It was really, really informative and very well done. So, but you definitely find things to do at PAX all 3 days. I mean, this was an incredibly good panel lineup. The expansion of the indie floor was absolutely amazing. Just a lot of the stuff there. It's, you know, I mentioned this before, I don't go there for the AAA stuff because I hear about that stuff all the time. I want to know what the indies are up to.
Yeah.
And
right, that's where you get out on the ground floor on that.
Yeah, it's, you know, and now because of just by talking to developers, there are games now that I am eagerly awaiting for. If I cannot donate to their Kickstarters because they've ended, then I'll wait until the game comes out. I know that a couple of games like Dragonfin Soup, for example, which I mentioned in the first half, just got greenlit by Steam, so they're going ahead. And so I'm definitely looking forward to that. And I will definitely be back next year. I already know the dates for next year. It's the weekend of March 6th through 8th. Even though it hasn't been officially announced yet by PAX, if you check out the Convention Center's website...
the MCCA.
The MCCA's website. They've got the calendar of events. And we've got PAX right up there, March 6th through 8th, 2015. So mark your calendars, people. Tickets won't go on sale for that, though, until after PAX Prime. And possibly even PAX... Well, no, it would be before. Because it was at PAX East that they announced there's going to be a new PAX.
Yeah.
PAX South. It's going to be in San Antonio, Texas.
I have a feeling they're going to... I'm waiting for PAX North so they can get all the directions. But I mean, I think it says something about the success they've had.
Absolutely.
And because, and you know, people, you know, can only go to so many because, I mean, if I, you know, I would say like in the middle of the country, like in Chicago or something, and I would really wanted to go, it's like, well, either trip's gonna set me back a good amount. So, I mean, granted, Chicago to San Antonio is not also not cheap, but it's more options, and I think you're going to start see, you know, a bit of a dip in how many people are going. I mean, they're still going to sell out, no doubt, but you're going to see it won't maybe not sell as fast because people have more options for which one they want to go to.
Yeah, and you know, even though
and that,
even though Penny Arcade is in the title of the convention, it's with each year it's becoming more and more less Penny Arcade and just more games.
Yeah, it's Raid Pop running the show mainly, at least at PAX East.
Yeah,
you know, they've attached the name because it's the name people know, but they are. I mean, the best way to describe it is basically the guys from Penny Arcade are the highest level of a guest of honor at this point.
Yeah, pretty much.
That's not a bad thing because I think they did enough work kind of in the foundation to kind of make sure it's an event they want and by token what's going to be there for the fans.
Exactly, because, I mean, we can't go to E3. E3 is a press-only event. And so, you know, we want to have that experience as gamers and as fans. So here we are.
Yeah.
So does anyone else have anything to say about this year's PAX? I know for you guys, this was your first. So this was my third. So, Doug, you've already said that. Go ahead.
Yeah, like I said in the beginning, it's a very different creature from the conventions that I tend to go to. And like I said, while I gamer second to a lot of my other interests, there is still a lot of good stuff. And we've hit the point over and over again, but at the core, it is still a convention. And the best way to ensure you have a good time is by interacting with your fellow fans. It could be the person in line, it could be the indie developer, it could be the guy at the Riot booth saying, do your favorite characters dance. And, I mean, the thing I kind of always say to people that the best way to have a good convention is to follow the advice of Bill and Ted, which is be excellent to each other. And that, PAX is no exception. The way you're going to have fun is get to know your fellow fan.
There you go. Now, Shanna, this was your first, so what was your overall take?
Oh my god, there was so much to do. I mean, like, I know next year when we go, I do want to make room for a bit more panels, because I didn't really get to go to that many. But, I mean, I loved every second of it. I loved the crowd, I loved meeting new people, I loved playing all sorts of new games that I'd never have a chance to play. I had fun just going and doing things. Like, I can't tell you how much time I spent watching I think it was either Just Dance or Dance Central, one of those games, but there was a table set up with just, you know, a stage set up with just people dancing the entire time. That was hilarious at points. Like,
go ahead, sorry. I gotta jump in at one point, though.
Okay. No, like, I have a couple of really good moments when I was there. Like, at one point, there was these two girls who were dressed up like Kid Icarus. And these poor girls, they could not pick their song up because their wings kept interfering with the Kinect. So they would, like, be sitting there waving their arms around trying to pick a song. And they'd put their arm down if they picked a song. And the menu would just keep spinning. And, like, for, like, 10 minutes, they couldn't play. And finally, this one guy just kind of comes up. He's like, all right, I got this. And he picked out the song for them. And then I got to watch two Kid Icaruses dance. there was another point when somebody was dancing to, I don't remember what it was, but there was a guy running around cosplaying a snake the entire weekend with a box over it, or that entire day with a box over his head. So in the middle of this one guy's, like, you know, dance session, all of a sudden, Snake creeps up from the back with the box over his head, just like just swaying in the background. I took some video of that. Yeah, I mean, I was doing that, and like I did a bit of the pin trading. I don't know if you guys did any of the pin stuff.
Oh, the Penny Arcade.
Yeah, the Penny Arcade, which, like, we didn't even really end up buying, like, the actual pins. We kind of just ended up trading with people enough where we got everything we wanted. That's the fun part. Like, that's exactly what you talk about. It's like, these people know their audience. We're gamers. We like doing stupid crap just to get prizes out of it. We love doing fetch quests and crap like that. So, like, you know, on Sunday, me and John and our friend Josh just ran around doing all this stuff just to get pins. Like, you get a if you played the Magic the Gathering demo, which I don't even play Magic, and I just played it, so I got a pin and I got a stupid picture taken. If you got a photo taken, I think, at Age of Empires, of like there's a picture of all of us attacking each other with fake weapons, and you got a pin for that. John managed to find the Leroy Jenkins crowd that was scurrying around, where you had to scream Leroy Jenkins as loud as possible, and then you got a pin for that. Like, and it was just so much fun. Like, I think the thing that I took away from it more than anything was, like, after going to things like Comic-Con for years where you can only have so much fun if you run out of money, like, I felt like I didn't even spend all the money I allotted for this weekend, but I had a blast the entire time. There's just so much to do and so much to experience, and the whole collective thing of it was just, it was amazing.
Well, there you go. And hopefully, we'll all be back next year.
Hopefully. This should be interesting, though, because, like, it'll be literally a month before both my wedding and Wyatt's. So that'll be fun to see.
Oh, you'll make it. You'll make it. I know you will. So, are we good?
I think so.
One more thing. There was a game called Bigfoot Hunter that was really fun. I think it's an iPhone game. I think it's an iOS game. But you had to, like, find the Bigfoot and take a photo of him. And if you missed the photo, you got, like, this, you know, the typical blurry Bigfoot photo. It was pretty fun. But, yeah, that's it.
Oh, no. All right.
So, let's wind this thing down. If you out there on the wide world of the internet went to PAX and want to throw in your two cents, give us your experiences, what you thought, then you can drop a message anywhere. Downloadable content is all over the internet. We've got facebook.com/dlcontent, Twitter at dlcontent, Tumblr dlcpodcast.tumblr.com. You can email dlcontent1@gmail.com. And as always, all episodes can be found on iTunes, YouTube, and Stitcher. So give us your thoughts, questions, comments on this episode or any other episode. Keep listening and do all the wonderful things that you do. So, once again, I would like to thank Doug. And don't forget to check out AnimeCons TV.
Ooh!
John and Wyatt, who buggered off, don't forget to check their blog out, spriceanddice.blogspot.com. Ben, who also vanished into the ether, thank him as well. And of course, it remains for me to thank Shanna as well for jumping in, racing home from work so she could get in on this.
Yeah, that was definitely tough, but I'm glad I made it.
Glad you did too. So on that wonderful note, I am Brian. Have a good one, everybody.